guests has given us some of the best British comedies of all time, while the other starred in one of the greatest Australian comedies to ever reach the screen. Now, Ben Elton and Michael Caton have teamed up for Three Summers, an all Aussie comedy with an A-list cast. Have a look.
It's a camping holiday, but with folk music. What's not to love?
I thought perhaps we might go and see a bit of music later.
Really? That's not like us.
Look at that dance troupe, skipping around naked, covered in paint. Bloody ridiculous.
We're just not exactly an obvious fit.
The best harmonies never are.
Why do I have to be on the end of the line, Henry? Somebody's got to be at the end of the line, Bob. It's the nature of a line that there's somebody on the end of it.
This is Queenie wishing you all a folking good night. It's a joke. Please don't write in.
Please welcome Ben Elton and Michael Caton.
Nice to see you again.
You too.
So good to have you.
Welcome.
What a pleasure.
What do you think of our disco entry?
Oh, the sliding door. I thought it was more Star Trek. I expected a Captain Kirk and a Uhura outside, you know.
That's right. It's Star Trek if Star Trek went even lower budget.
Yeah. Hey, Ben, where did the idea for this wonderful movie come from?
Well, it's a multi-character, all quirky Aussie comedy with a romance at the centre, and it's all set at this fictitious but real rural folk festival. It's set in the Binjara region of WA, which is about 100 miles from where I live in Fremantle with my family, and there's a real folk festival called the Fairbridge Festival. And we've been going there for years and hanging out. It's a great family event. And I just thought it'd be a wonderful place to set a whole load of different, disparate Aussie stories clashing with each other, because everyone loves music. So all types of different people, you know, we're all equal in the queue for the Portaloos. So I just thought it'd be a great
But it's an Australian movie, isn't it? And you know, I was in New York once and I was feeling homesick and I found Crocodile Dundee was on and I looked at it and I thought, oh, I feel so much better now. I've had a bit of Australia. And there's something about going to an Australian movie. It's like you saying, Hemet, you know, at the end of the bloody line, there's a line. You know, that's the way the line works. You think, yes, I love that about it. That's what I love about Australian movies.
Well, it's certainly, for me, it was a wonderful privilege for me to be finally telling stories as an Australian. I mean, when I first came here 30 years ago, I wrote a thing called Stark, which was kind of like a POM looking in. I was living with my girlfriend, who's now my wife. And now, 30 years later, I live in Frio, and I'm writing the story from the inside. And certainly the comedy and the atmosphere of West Australia and the broader Australian community, it's a wonderful thing to play with when you write comedy. And then you get someone like Michael to play your Morris man. You know that you've got some serious fun out.
Because, Michael, I loved you in the film, because you start out as being quite a grumpy old bastard.
You say that.
No, but you do. But then you...
It was just misunderstood.
Exactly, but that I think is what is so lovely about your character. It must have been fun to play.
It was. And you were in great company.
Well, I was going to say, we saw some of them then. You've got some absolutely stellar co-stars. You've got Magda Zabanski, John Waters, Deborah Mailman.
Yeah.
What's it like?
Jacqueline McKenzie.
What's it?
And our security guard.
Steals every
single.
But when she clashes with Jackie and sparks really fly, what was so great about writing an ensemble piece was the chance to cast, and of course, I never dreamt I'd get every single bit of casting. Everyone agreed. I mean, Magda to play the kind of queen bee radio personality with a finger in every pie. She's got a big heart.
Who would
she's
say
meddling
no to
with
you,
everyone.
Though? Who would say no to Ben?
Well, that's a very kind thought, but it was on the strength of the script, I think. Mm-hmm. You know, they also will read the script. And you know, when Michael came back, I met Michael. We had a lovely lunch, Isaiah, just a couple of bottles. By the end of it, the deal was done.
Yes. What was it like making the film? I mean, with people like that all together, it must have been pretty fun. Was there any sort of behind-the-scenes hijinks that...
I refuse to answer. What happens on the shoot stays on the shoot.
It was a lot of fun.
I shouldn't have given my speakers to Kel.
Kelton Pearl, who plays... Because, obviously, Michael leads the Morris men, the traditional English folk dancers, and, of course, he clashes with Kelton Pearl's Noongar dance troupe.
Yep.
There's a clash of cultures and a bit of a dance-off. There we are all working. But the truth is, you know, the film was shot in 25 days.
Wow. Really?
Films, you know, you have... And that's a testimony to the quality quality of our wonderful crews. I mean, the reason Thor comes to be made here is because our crews, our technical base, is so splendid. And the reason they're so fantastic is because on the little budgets we have for our Aussie movies, which are great and so grateful to have it, you know, we had to make Three Summers in 25 days. So not a lot of time to kind of mess around and have hijinks. But it was a very loving set, wasn't it? There was a whole feeling of community.
The pity was that I didn't get to work with Deb. I've always wanted to work with Deborah.
Yeah, she's amazing.
And we just, our ships did not meet on the
shoot.
Well,
you didn't have to go to the meetings.
Meetings. Yeah. Deborah's story meets John Waters' story, whereas, of course, Michael's story is meeting Kelton's story. Mm. The whole idea is this, I guess if we all listen to each other a little bit more and all kind of take a little view outside our own little world, we might perhaps understand the broader Australian community a little bit better. And look, clearly, there's no message to the movie. I'm an entertainer, but I hope that the big heart comes across.
That's what I loved about it. Yeah. Made me laugh, made me cry.
That's right. The message is go and see it.
That's on the poster.
Well, we will be back with more from Ben and Michael as we look back at their early careers. And, Michael, just wait until you see what we've dug up.
Oh, no.
See you in a sec. Lucky to have special guests Michael Caton and Ben Elton at our brand new studio 10 desk.
Very lovely.
Now, but is it true that you are related to Olivia Newton-John?
This is one of my claims to fame, and I only third cousin, which I think means I was definitely allowed to fancy her during a brief period. But
must have made many uncomfortable.
We share a great grandfather who's a nuclear physicist called Max Born. We've never met, we've almost met, and of course I admire it like everyone. She's a great showbiz icon and a great ambassador for Australia. But we've never actually met, but we are distant relatives. Third cousin is quite a long
time. I'd love to see a collaboration.
Yeah, it would be, absolutely. I should be so lucky. But
she could be in Four Summers, maybe.
It's a funny thing, but she is, a nuclear physicist is back in both our lineages.
Wow.
Yes.
That stunned you.
Yes. I had to make this meeting
at all.
Happen.
Absolutely.
I can't believe you haven't met.
We've got tears, they're multiplying, and we're losing control.
Now, Michael, you, of course, are beloved by so many of us. What would be your favourite character? I mean, a lot of Aussies, I mean, my brother-in-law knows every word to the castle.
Yeah, right.
Would that be one of your favourite characters,
Daryl? Oh, God, yeah. How could it not be?
Mm.
Yeah, I mean, that came at a time when I couldn't get arrested.
Well, actually, you could get arrested, you just couldn't get a job.
I think the house went up for sale, the actual castle house went up for sale
and then they were going to cart it to Corowa, and then I think it's now heading down Ballarat.
It should be a museum.
Yeah.
So good. And it
should be up there.
One of the truly great comedy movies of all time. I often mention it people say, what are your favourite movies? I say, well, I don't know if you know the movie The Castle. Actually, quite a lot of people do know it overseas. Mm. The Working Dog Gang was so original. Mm. I mean, what they did, when people talk about The Office, you know, Ricky Gervais's great groundbreaking sitcom, but I tell people about Frontline, which preceded it.
Yes.
Which was the great comedy of personal embarrassment. Mm. A nuanced dagginess, which actually very similar in many ways to The Office, but actually earlier. So, you know, part of the Working Dog Gang, they made it.
Jane Kennedy's character made me want to be a journalist.
if you watch Frontline even now, 20 years old, like it is still just as good and just as fresh. As is, Benjamin, your incredible work. I'm just such a huge fan of your work. The Young Ones, the Blackadder. I mean, these are.
Have you got a video?
Oh my God, that
I love that.
Stephen Fry, Hugh Laurie. A video nasty. Yeah, well, that's gone back a long way. I'm quite fortunate now because, believe it or not, I've actually got a new sitcom on the BBC, and it's been quite a success. My first TV hit this century, actually, because it was a little bit of a bleak period, like Michael had before The Castle. It's about Shakespeare, so it's quite Blackadder-ish in a way, and hopefully it'll be on Oz Telly next year.
And these are such brilliant shows, and they define a generation. We can quote every word, but you've also talked about the death of the sitcom, haven't you, and how you're worried that in the age of social media, where everything gets killed before it gets born, that
well, it's more political correctness, isn't it? I think you were saying it was political correctness.
Well, it was a lecture. What you're referring to, I was very honoured to be invited to deliver the inaugural Ronnie Barker lecture on the BBC. The BBC have done something rather wonderful. They're going to have an annual lecture on the art of comedy, and each year they're going to ask a practitioner to do it, and I was the first, which was splendid. And I just talked about my love of the studio sitcom, the sitcom with a live audience. Mm. People often say, oh, all that canned laughter. It's never canned. It's just live laughter, which is recorded along with the piece. And what I was defending was the fact that it's a style. It allows the actors to really work with the audience. Mm. So when you watch a live sitcom like The Blackadder or Friends or whatever, you're seeing the actor's natural timing. When you see a one camera sitcom like The Office, what you're seeing is the editor's interpretation of that timing made later in an edit suite. Now, both are wonderful and produce great work, but somehow or other, the studio sitcom has become to be seen as somewhat naff and old-fashioned, and I made the case for the studio sitcom.
Difference between British humour and Australian humour? Is the British humour more subtle?
No, I wouldn't say more subtle. I was speaking about Frontline and what recently. I mean, the idea. There's a lot of similarities. I mean, people are similar, I think, worldwide. I mean, if you were a stand-up, I always use the same example of it's all about the nuance of embarrassment and frustration. So we all know if we're both stood in a queue at the post office and there's another queue, we're all looking at the other queue thinking that one's moving faster. Now, you could do that routine anywhere, from Toronto to Tehran. So there's something that unites the whole human family, but of course there are local differences, and between Britain and Australia, they're subtler. But honestly, Australian comedy is as... I mean, we lost the great John Clarke, who was a friend of mine.
Yeah.
And you can't... You will never know a dry... I mean, he was drier than the Nullarbor. Yeah. You know, he was... the man was iconic in his ability to deadpan the comedy out of anything, the most serious situations. So I would say that I've had the great good fortune, because of my weird twist in the road where I met my wife and became Australian-British, British-Australian, whatever, and now in Australia for good, and, you know, this is part of my life. I've had the chance to know both industries very well, as I say, mentioning Working Dog. And the days of Full Frontal and the great sketch days where we first saw the likes of Magda, you know, Peter Moon, all those great days. So, no, I think there are differences, but there's a great brother-sisterhood, kinhood between the two countries, and I've been so happy and privileged to be part of both.
I just want to show everyone at home a bit of a clip now. Have a look at this.
Hey, mister! I'll keep the ball looking this way if you can get the lady into the car. OK? Hey! Hello! Hey!
Come on.
That was my second TV gig.
Oh.
That's incredible. Is that you and the kangaroo suit?
Yeah, that's it. I can do everything.
What are your memories of Skippy?
The bull. It was the mildest bull. You need an electric cattle prod to get it chilly.
That was your second TV gig?
Yeah.
What was your first?
Oh, the first one was a Riptide. And they did the wide shot, and then I went to the director and said, how was that? And he says, good, good. I went home.
Oh.
No reverses, close-ups, nothing. I went home.
That's
right. As far as I'm concerned, I did it.
That's right.
Ben, it's been so great having you, and I just have to say, your movie is sensational. Three Summers. It's a really beautiful story. It really encourages people to go and see it. It's amazing.
Australian cinema, the audiences need to support our local industry.
Yes.
We want them to see our film, don't we?
Yeah.
And have a good laugh at the
same time. Yeah, you do.
Well,
November the 2nd, it's going nationwide. Thank you.
Three Summers opens on November 2. Please thank Ben and Michael.
Thank you. Thank you.